Do you change that every single day, or does someone else in your class? Because every day it's different. It's a school bus, the battery, something.
Yeah, I don't. Well, I don't
do bubbles.
Really? Every day.
End of February. It's kind of wild that there's really only two big units left. There's just waves and then electricity. So waves, we divide our discussion into mechanical waves and electromagnetic waves, also known as sound and light. So we're going to first talk about mechanical waves and sound, and then we'll talk about electromagnetic waves and light, which is actually kind of fun. And then after that, it's all electromagnetism, which is basically electricity. And we break that into current that doesn't move, current that moves, circuits, and magnetism. And we're all done. Hard to believe we're only like 14 weeks away from the end of the school year. Yeah. Trip out. Okay, so, and I'll demonstrate this when we get to sound. This is a Rubens tube. They're really fun. So today we're going to start talking about mechanical waves, okay? And one of the top discussions we're going to have is the difference between mechanical waves and electromagnetic waves. Now, mechanical waves are shock waves that require a medium, okay? So both sound and light are waves. Today, we're going to start talking about mechanical waves, which are sound waves, or the basis for sound waves. Later on, in a couple weeks, then we'll talk about light waves. So jumping right in, two types of waves. And the waves are usually classified based upon what they do to what they're moving through and whether or not they need something to move through. When we usually talk about waves, we think of like sine waves and cosine waves, we're usually thinking about transverse waves. So transverse literally means across the path or between the path. So when you transect something, you go across it. So transverse waves move the medium, whatever the molecules are, or whatever's carrying it, they move the medium perpendicular to the wave travel. So if in this case our diagram, if the wave is moving from left to right, then the molecules are moving up and down. So a transverse wave, the wave energy causes the medium to move perpendicular to the wave. Transverse wave. When we think about waves and we draw waves, we usually draw transverse waves because they're easy. So you're like, draw a wave. And you're like, wave. Sines and cosines usually draw transverse waves because they're easy to visualize. They're easy to visualize. They have a high point and a low point. Unfortunately, most of the waves that we're going to talk about today in the next couple days are not transverse waves. They're called longitudinal waves. Longitudinal waves, like shock waves, move the media parallel to the wave direction. So they move it with the wave energy. They move it parallel with the wave energy. A shock wave is a transverse wave, and sound waves are transverse waves. I'm sorry about the red color and how they're so dark down here. But one of the things we're going to ask you in a few weeks is, how come the bottom of my projector is a lot darker on the screen than the top of the screen? So the projector's up there. How come the top is always brighter than the bottom? Yeah, the light has to go that far to the top, but that far to the bottom. Unless the projector is calibrated for that, like they are in the new building, then you get this issue where all the colors are washed out and it's dark down here. Because I'm in the old building. It's all a package deal. Yeah. C'est la vie. But yeah, there's actually a formula that we can use to determine how much light intensity is encountered down here versus how much light intensity is encountered down here, or up here. I even have a light sensor. One of these days I'm going to test it. Figure, since I do But anyway, so in this unit, we're going to be talking about longitudinal waves. Longitudinal waves move the material they're in parallel to the wave travel. If you pick your favorite dot, it goes back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. As the wave energy moves from left to right, the material's moving back and forth. Now, one of the biggest differences between longitudinal waves and transverse waves is transverse waves don't need a medium to travel. The light that comes from the sun, radio waves, gamma rays, all that stuff is transverse. It doesn't require a medium. Longitudinal waves, however, do require a medium. Ah, perfect. Okay. So a good example is if you have to stay in your seat, and if Briggs pushes on DJ and DJ pushes on Taylor, we make a longitudinal wave. So Briggs give a pulse to DJ, and DJ gives a pulse to Taylor, and Taylor can give a pulse to Jarrett, and so on and so forth. Okay? So the medium is required. For you to hear me, I have to cause the air in front of my face to vibrate. And that vibrating air creates a shock wave that propagates across the room. If there was no air right here, you couldn't hear me. If I was in a little vacuum chamber, I could scream and yell, you wouldn't be able to hear anything. Because my wave energy would just go, eh, there's nothing for it to bounce into. Okay? Kind of like if Zadi was to try to give Julia a push. Zadi can't, because there's this big gap in between. You're like, I have nothing to push on. So transverse waves don't need that. Transverse waves don't need a medium. They just, the wave energy is the medium. They don't have to worry about having an extra medium. Longitudinal waves do have to have a medium. Okay. Does that idea make sense? Pretty important. So, you know, when they hear, like, you hear there's no sound in space, despite what Star Wars does, like, pew, pew, pew. And yeah, there's no sound in space. You're not going to hear it when the Enterprise flies over you. Or when the Millennium Falcon flies past you, it's not going to go whoosh. Because there's no sound in space. It will go.
It's my favorite sound.
Yeah. What about what? No. I mean, you would hear a shockwave as the remnants of the destroying planet reached you. You would hear something, because then there'd be a vibration carried with that material, but you wouldn't hear anything otherwise. You'd be like, "Ooh, look, Alderaan blew up." Then you'd hear the shockwave. They're like, "Brrr!" as it passed you, but that would basically, that's all you would hear. You wouldn't hear anything as it happened. Sorry, yeah. Yeah, very few science fiction shows do that. In fact, it's not really science fiction. Very few science-y fantasy shows do that. I guess Space Odyssey, 2001, 2010, there was a show called Babylon 5 where they made a point that, like, there's no sound in space, which unfortunately most of you have not heard. Yeah, or radios. Keep the air in our heads. Okay. So, sound waves are longitudinal waves. They need a medium to travel. In general, they travel about 340 meters per second in air. And that number is very fluid. It goes up and down depending upon what kind of medium it's traveling in. Anything that can make the molecules move faster or bounce into each other faster or more often will increase the speed of sound. Yes? They were like opening the spacesuit. Hey, can you hear me? Hey, John. Yeah, Buzz. No, I would imagine long before we went to space, because there was no material. So one of the things that we could do if we had a good vacuum pump, and a lot of physics classes do, is they put a little bell in a jar, and they suck the jar, and they suck the air out, and as the air gets sucked out, the bell gets quieter and quieter and quieter so you can't hear it anymore. And the reason I'm not doing it, and I'm telling you about it instead, is our vacuum pump sucks, and only doesn't suck good enough. It sucks not great. It only has moderate sucking ability, so the noise never goes away. But yeah, if we had a vacuum pump that sucked really well, then we could do that where we put the bell in the jar and then it just disappears, or the sound goes away. Unfortunately, we don't. You're welcome. So, anything that causes the molecules to hit more often will increase the speed of sound. That means if the air is denser, if it's under high pressure, making it dense, then the speed of sound will go up. Also, if it's hotter, if the air molecules are hotter, they're moving faster, the speed of sound will go up. One thing that is kind of fun, because it is so cold, but the pressure is so low, the speed of sound actually decreases as we increase in altitude. So down here, not close to sea level, but close enough, speed of sound is about 340 meters per second. It's about 300 up where planes fly. This is about 720 miles per hour. There's a hard speed limit for airplanes, commercial airliners, and it's about 550 miles per hour, because if they go any faster than that, there's a chance they'll break the sound barrier, which could be really, really bad. And we'll talk about what sonic booms are later on and what happens when you try to break the sound barrier. Yeah.
Okay, this might not have anything to do with this, but you know when you're in a plane and you feel like, you know, you're talking at a normal sound, but everything seems quieter? Is that because of, like, you're up so high, or is that because your ears are flooded?
That's because you're constantly bombarded with din. You're constantly bombarded with noise. So your ears try to adjust.
Okay.
Yeah. That's just because airplanes, even good ones, they still have a low rumble that your ears just like they get tired of, and your ears just like, I don't want to talk to you right now. So light travels a lot faster. Light travels at 300 million meters per second. A lot faster. So consider this. Let's say we're on the top of the school, we were looking out, and something over the desert, there was a huge explosion. Are you more likely to see the explosion or hear the explosion first? Yeah, you're going to see it. You're going to see it first. Unless you're blind. But then consider this.
Is that your kind of humor?
Then consider this. Are you more likely to hear it first or feel the shockwave in the ground first?
In the ground or
are you
first?
Oh, I did. You did the crossword. And we talked about density. If molecules are really close together, they will collide more often or less often? More often. So, sound waves travel faster in more dense medium. The exact same shock or explosion that creates a shock wave in air that we perceive as sound would create a shock wave in the ground that we would perceive as an earthquake. So, what would happen is when there's the explosion, we would see it first, then we feel it, then we hear it. Most Hollywood things don't get this right, because the flash of a bullet or the flash of a gun going off will not happen at the same time as you hear the bullet, and that won't happen at the same time as the bullet hits the person. Because a bullet travels 2 to 3 times the speed of sound. Sound travels the speed of sound, and light travels even faster. So if you're way off and you're seeing some guy shoot, and you're holding your target right here, William Tell, okay, miles off with his gun. Oh, you're going to see the flash. Then what's going to happen? Then the bullet's going to shatter your target. Then you're going to hear it. Very few movies realize this, because most movie producers are stupid. And they think you're stupid, so they don't want to confuse you. Yeah. I saw that movie last night. Yeah. That's a fun movie. Yeah. What a quinkydink. Not last night. Night before last. I watched it night before. It's a fun movie. Yeah. But yeah. So, there's no love. He's autistic. Yeah.
Is that why that trick of putting your ear to the ground works?
Yep. So, Sean asks, is that why that trick putting your ear to the ground works? It does, because things travel faster through, like, a railroad train, a railroad rail will carry this vibration from the rail faster than the sound will, or the air will. You get one guy on one mountain, another guy on another mountain with a flashlight. Really.
Is that honestly how they do it?
They act honestly how they do it.
That.
Only they have a really good timer and a really good flashlight.
Okay, that's about...
Okay, guys, there's a third type of wave. It is a hybrid wave, and that's called a surface wave. Ocean waves and earthquake waves are surface waves, where they will pick up their matter and move it both transverse and longitudinally. So ocean waves are surface waves. They move their media both longitudinally, parallel, and transverse, perpendicular. So if you pick your favorite dot, you might notice the dot's kind of moving in a circle. That's a surface wave. Earthquakes, ocean waves, tsunamis. Anything that is bound by two very, very different densities, like ground air and water air. Okay.
Sound moves faster in the air than the water.
Sound moves a lot faster in, what do you think, air or water?
I guess water.
Water. Why? It's more dense. Yeah. Sound moves about 4 or 5 times faster in water. I think it's 1,500 meters per second in water. It's not a linear relationship. Doubling the density doesn't double the speed of sound. There's some crazy math involved, which you're interested in. Wikipedia is your best friend. But in general, the faster the density, the bigger the density, the faster the sound wave is. For longitudinal waves, it's exactly the opposite for transverse waves. We'll talk about that. So two ways to make a wave. One is with a pulse. So one's with a pulse, and one is with reverberation. If you could clap fast enough that every time a wave left, you made another one. He made that up, you know that? Movie trivia. Yeah. He made that up on the spot. It wasn't in the script. Okay, so pulses usually make a longitudinal wave. But if you make a pulse immediately after the first pulse leaves, we call that reverberation, or simple harmonic motion, or vibration. This can make longitudinal waves, or it can make transverse waves. So repeated pulses at regular intervals will create longitudinal waves or transverse waves. Unit and our last unit on simple harmonic motion, because we're still talking about periods, how long something takes, and frequency, how many takes you get in 1 second. That's what this stands for. SHM is simple harmonic motion, like a bouncing of a spring. If you bounce a spring and put a pen on the end of it, it'll make a transverse wave.
So technically, I already studied waves partially.
Mm-hmm. It's also why your textbook, if you were to use the textbook, they put simple harmonic motion and wave mechanics in the same unit. and then they leave a whole bunch of space, and then they do sound. Or you get the idea. So I just like to do it with sound. I just like to do it with sound because it feels like that's where it should belong. All right, so that's wave energy traveling through a material. Wavelength is the length of a wave. If you look at a transverse wave, and I'm going to use transverse waves just because they're easier to see, they're easier to draw. If you look at a transverse wave, the length of a wave would be from crest to crest or from trough to trough. That would be the length of a wave. And it is given the Greek letter lambda, which is like a teepee with a chimney. So to make a lambda, it's usually left side, right side, like that. Lambda. Lambda, 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 lambda. Or upside down Y. If you can't make it, just turn your paper upside down and make a Y. Period is the time for one wave to travel. If the x-axis of their diagram is distance or length, then you have wavelength. If the x-axis is time, then you have period. And the y-axis is almost always energy or intensity or amplitude. We'll talk about amplitude in a second. So if you're looking at a diagram of a wave and the x-axis is time, you're looking at one period from there to there. If you're looking at the x-axis and that axis is distance or displacement, then you're looking at wavelength from crest to crest. Frequency is still the inverse of period. But with sound waves, frequency is also called pitch. A high-frequency wave will have a high pitch. A low-frequency wave will have a low pitch. When you're dropping the bass, you have a low frequency. You have very few waves per second. Sometimes as few as 20 or 25 waves per second. Amplitude is wave energy, the intensity of the wave, a rough idea of how much wave energy is being carried through the wave. And amplitude is measured from the equilibrium point, the zero point, up to the crest, or from the equilibrium point down to the trough. That's amplitude. Thing you got to watch out for is if you have to measure from crest to trough, make sure you divide that by two, because amplitude is from equilibrium to crest or from equilibrium to trough. So if the top of the wave is 5 units and the bottom of the wave is -5 units, then the amplitude is 5, not 10. Yeah. If the top of the wave is 1 unit and the bottom of the wave is -1 unit, then the amplitude is 1 unit, not 2 units. This is just like you learned in pre-calculus or trigonometry, the sines and cosines. They might use different language, but the idea is still the same. When we do a lab, we're actually going to look at sound waves, and the computer is going to translate the longitudinal sound waves into a transverse wave so we can measure it. I'll show you what that looks like later on. Okay, questions? Why this string is so long, but this is a really cool device. Hello.
I need your signature, please.
For
Mr. Stuckelberg.
I apologize, but would you sign this picture to the phone? Hope he goes out to bed.
Thank you. He doesn't know anyone.
Fair enough. Okay. So, this is a shock out of a DualShock from a PlayStation. All it is a motor with a half circle of metal. The same idea is going on in your cell phone. Your cell phone vibrates. It's just a motor with a rotor that's basically a half of a piece of metal, like a half moon. And all that happens is it spins, and when you spin, the thing vibrates back and forth. It's kind of cool. And then I tied a string to it and put a 9-volt battery on it. So you can do this at home. All you need is a DualShock controller, or an Xbox controller, and there we go. And a 9-volt battery to power it up. Can you see what's going on here? We'll get a little bit closer. So this is called a standing wave. I sent energy down the string, or actually up the string, and it hit my thumb and came back, creating a wave that you can see. And it's called a standing wave because it's constantly reinforced. Now, if I change that, I can completely ruin the wave. This is called dissonance, and this is called resonance. If I get to the mechanical frequency of the wave, it'll vibrate, or the string in this case. Now, something kind of interesting happens when energy goes up and down a string. What direction is the wave energy moving the string? Starts with a T and ends in erse. Transverse. So when wave energy is traveling through a string, let me get to this one here. There we are. So now we have, look at that. Let's try that again. Okay. So when wave energy is traveling through a string, it moves that string back and forth transverse. Now I mentioned that longitudinal wave energy travels faster in more dense medium. It's the opposite for transverse. I forgot this was here. Okay, so we'll get to that idea in a second. So here's three waves, A, B, and C. They're both standing waves. They're waves that have been reinforced, where this thing bounced up and down and went back and forth. This one back and forth. I have three questions. First one, which one has the greatest amplitude? A. You can tell, right? More thicky? It has a higher degree of thickness? Okay. So, yeah. Which wave? This is important, guys. Listen to this. Which wave has a wavelength of 2 meters? Realize, from this distance from here to here is 1 meter. Which one has a wavelength of 2 meters? Okay. With a show of hands, which of you believe that wave A has a wavelength of 2 meters? 5 or 6. Okay. With a show of hands, which of you believe wave B has a wavelength of 2 meters? And some of you are just afraid to guess even though you're not on camera. It's wave A.
Oh.
Because if you're going to have a transverse wave, you need a crest and a trough, right? Well, here's one crest, and here's one trough. So wave A, you're seeing a crest for 1 meter, and then a trough for 1 meter. Wave A has a wavelength of 2 meters. Wave B, you have a crest and a trough. Wave B has a wavelength of 1 meter. 1, 2. And wave C, crest, trough, would have a wavelength of 0.67 or 2/3. Which wave has the greatest frequency? C, yeah. C has the greatest frequency because there's three of them here. They're making lots of waves. Okay, so formula. Frequency is still the inverse of period. Frequency is still the inverse of period. If your wave takes a half a second to be made, it has a period of 0.5, you would have a frequency of 2 hertz. Still a mathematical inverse, just like simple harmonic motion. But when we want to know how fast a wave is moving through a string, or actually fast at all, if we want to know how fast a wave is moving, we want a velocity. Velocity has what unit? Yeah, meters per second. So velocity would equal what two things multiplied together? What thing in wave gives us meters? Wavelength. Good. And what thing in waves gives us per second? Frequency. So wave speed is wavelength divided by period, or wavelength times frequency. Usually, this one is used, and this one if you need it. This is rarely used, but velocity is frequency times wavelength. Is primarily what we usually use for wave speed. next part is about wave in a stream. Again, if you want to make one, all you need is a DualShock controller, preferably your little brother's, or an Xbox controller, and then a 9-volt battery. Now, I can't do this, I can't really show this with the wave doing its thing, but the wave energy is moving transverse. Ooh, look at that. There we go. If I was to pull down on this, I would increase the tension. Fortunately, when I do pull it, all the energy goes into my hand. But if I was to pull down on the shock or make the shock heavier, I increase the tension. How do you think wave speed is going to change? It's either going to go faster or slower. Watch this. Okay, see the piece of string? I'm going to send a wave pulse down the piece of string. See how fast the wave is moving across? It's going like wobble, 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 wobble. It's so slow, you can actually see the wave move across the string. Is this very taut? Is there a lot of tension here? No. If I give it a lot of tension, can you see how fast the wave's moving through? It looks like it's basically instantaneous. Like flick, flick, flick. It looks like when I flick it, the whole thing goes up and the whole thing goes down. So when you increase the tension, the wave speed will actually increase. So not a lot of tension, it's a pretty slow wave. Lots of tension, it's a fast wave. In fact, even if I just give it a little bit, like a little bit of sink, I can still see it moving back and forth. I can still see the wave go back. But if I give it tension, it's so fast I can't tell. So of course there's a formula for this. Wave speed on a string is given to you by radical tension over density. Tension over density. The mu is a special kind of density. It's linear density, not like a rho, where the rho's are kilogram per cubic meter, mass over kilogram, or mass over volume. This is mass over length. It's linear density. So if you increase the tension, you increase the speed. But if you make the material more dense, you decrease the speed, because the kind of wave that's happening in that is a transverse wave. I'll say that again for those who are not writing. As longitudinal wave energy travels through a more dense medium, it's faster in a more dense medium. Transverse energy is inverted. Transverse energy is slower in a more dense medium. So longitudinal wave energy is faster in a more dense medium. Transverse energy is slower in a more dense medium. That's going to be a big deal when we get to optics. And we talk about how fast light travels through things. The more dense something is, the slower light will travel, because light is a transverse phenomenon. Does that idea make sense? It's kind of goofy, but I want to make sure we're all on the same page. Sean?
So would that be part of the reason why the ocean gets darker as deeper you go? Or is it something else? Just like
that? It's probably part of it, yeah. Most of it is just because light has to go from molecule to molecule to molecule, and as it does, it spreads out. We find that light energy falls off with the square of distance. Sound does too. So as you travel, your voice gets quieter and light gets dimmer. So as it travels, it just gets dimmer and dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. Question? Mu is mass over length. It's a linear density. Remember how density is kilogram per cubic meter? Mu is kilogram per meter. Linear density. Basically, the density of the string. Okay, so somebody asked earlier, is this why you can put your ear to a railroad rail or put your ear to the ground and hear something coming? That is exactly why. sound travels faster, longitudinal sound waves travel faster through more dense mediums because the molecules are closer together. They hit more often. Kind of like if we got you really, really close, there's a really good chance that Briggs's impulse, Briggs's shove, could actually get to Camille really fast. If you were like shoulder to shoulder, really close together, Briggs could give a shove and might even push Camille right out of her seat because you'd be so close together. So the closer you are together, the faster that wave impulse moves through the material. The closer the molecules are, the faster the wave impulse moves through the material. So when you increase density, you increase longitudinal wave speed, you decrease transverse wave speed. This is also why you're going to see the explosion because it's light, then you're going to feel it in the ground, then you're going to hear it. Ooh, okay, let me talk about that for you. Give you the wall of text. The wall of text. TLDR. Too long. Didn't read that wall of text. Too long. Okay. The reason that gymnasiums have really, really bad acoustics, and you don't want to have a concert in the gymnasium, and it's really rough to try to play music in the gymnasium, is because the block walls are very, very dense. Sound travels out of the speaker, through the air, and then when it strikes something more dense, it gets reflected back. Anytime wave energy hits a new medium, like my voice into the air, and then the air off this table or the floor or the walls, anytime wave energy strikes a new medium, how much gets reflected is based upon the differences in those two mediums. So you see this ball of air right here? How is their density different? Same density. So is any wave energy lost as it travels through, as my voice travels through? None. However, if I put something that is more dense, like a book, how does my voice change when the book is in the way? Yeah, because most of the wave energy is bouncing off the book, and then bouncing off the whiteboard, and you have that difference in bouncing, so some energy goes into the book and then bounces, some energy goes off the whiteboard and bounces. How much gets absorbed and how much gets reflected is based upon the differences in density. Now, I'm not going to give you a formula because the formula is really nasty. Again, if you're curious, Wikipedia. There's lots of formulas for that. But what you do need to know is this. When wave energy comes back, the type of wave energy that comes back depends upon whether the density went up or went down. In this room, when I'm talking, the wave energy bouncing off the walls comes back inverted because the walls are more dense than the air carrying the wave energy. But my face and my skull, when my skull is vibrating, sending out my voice, the wave energy that goes into the air is upright because the air is less dense than my face. So when wave energy goes to a more dense material, the wave energy that gets reflected will be inverted. That means upside down or backwards. When the wave energy goes into a less dense material, the wave energy will be similar or upright, which is like basically same orientation. Musical instruments this phenomenon to make sound vibrate over and over itself, kind of build up. If you only want to hear the sound once, it's really, really bad. So if someone goes, and you want to hear, and not, then you want the sound to basically bounce one time or not at all. Now, this room is great because I don't have to talk very loud, and the sound just bounces all over the walls because we have a hard wall and hard floor, so I don't have to talk very loud. Teachers in the new building that have carpet have to talk louder because, or use the microphone, because their sound is constantly being absorbed into the carpet. Carpet is very low density, so not a lot of energy is bouncing off the floor. I think it would be really great if we could take like big sheets of carpet and hang them from the ceiling in the gymnasium. It would make the assemblies a lot easier to listen to. You could actually hear what Michael's saying. Like, it's like, I can't understand a thing you said. Because your voice just bounced 60 times in the last second. Okay, last thing and then we're done for today. In fact, the bell's about to ring. So I'll just basically put this in your ear. The idea is superposition. When two waves overlap, they algebraically or arithmetically add their amplitudes. As observers, we see this happen. But the waves themselves don't know it's happening. The waves themselves are unchanged. For instance, if I sing, and somebody else sings right next to me, our wave energies will overlap. If you were in front of us, you would detect a obvious change in amplitude. Our waves don't see that. So we'll revisit this tomorrow. Yeah?